The authoritarian power structure of any military institution retains a psychological emphasis that is imperative to how its inner systems operate. The hierarchical command creates a centralized authority that encompasses a vast amount of behavioral science and refinement. The armed forces systematically develops its officers to make dispassionate and strategically calculated decisions that in times of war will often have a dramatic impact on both the service personnel serving under their command and for the civilian population inhabiting the area of conflict. The importance of conformity and obedience is relentlessly ingrained into volunteers throughout indoctrination, and essentially forges a mindset that ensures the fast and accurate transmission of orders and communications. There is no room for error nor hesitation in the field of military operations, and total respect and acquiescence to any superior is essential. This is the reason enlisted personnel are commonly addressed by surnames or nicknames, whereas officers are recognized by rank, and the higher an officer climbs in the command structure, the greater the importance of these hierarchical monikers become. David Russell Williams enrolled in the Royal Canadian Air Force in 1987 and was soon promoted to captain by January 1, 1991. From that moment on, he would have been addressed as Sir by his subordinates and Captain Williams by his superiors. Described as an elite pilot and shining bright star of the military, he quickly rose through the ranks and was promoted to Colonel in June of 2004, while also being appointed the role of commanding officer at CFB Trenton, Canada's largest Air Force base. He was essentially in full command of over 7,000 military personnel, all of whom would have then referred to him as Colonel or Colonel Williams without exception. This would have afforded him an extensive amount of psychosocial equanimity and confidence, and wasn't exclusive to his work life. His designated title of Colonel would have been printed on all forms of identification, and every formal encounter would sanctify this military standing. A doctor, lawyer, police officer, or any other figure of authority would recognize and comply to the traditional courtesy of addressing him by his professional rank, boosting his composure and self-assurance each and every time as his elevated social standing and military achievements were accentuated for all to see. There was one exception, however, and that was the day he met Detective Sergeant Jim Smith.
You just have to see Russell.
Before clarifying the psychological relevance as to why a senior detective would purposefully refrain from addressing a highly respected military commander by his formal title, first consolidate each of the elements and circumstances that led to the crossing of paths between these two profoundly dissimilar yet equally fascinating individuals. 10 days earlier, on January 28th of 2010, Andy Lloyd received a call from his mother around midday stating that his younger sister, 27-year-old Jessica Lloyd, had failed to show up to work and wasn't responding to phone calls or text messages. He immediately drove to her isolated home on Ontario's Highway 37 and discovered she wasn't there. There was no sign of a break-in, yet Jessica was known for leaving her doors unlocked, and all of her personal items were still inside the premises, including her phone, passport, and driver's license. Ottawa is known for its remarkably low crime rate and widely recognized as the safest city in Canada. The local authorities had resources to spare, and a missing person's investigation was launched immediately, which included an entire division from the Ottawa Police Force, over 2,000 members of the public, and even a specialist search and rescue unit from the Canadian Air Force. The word spread extremely fast across the city through the help of the media, and on the second day of Jessica's disappearance, an anonymous member of the public came forward with vital information. He stated that while driving home from work the night before, at roughly 3 a.m., he drove past Jessica's house and noticed an SUV parked in a field just a short distance away. He stated that he remembered feeling that something just seemed off, as it was parked in such an unusual area at such a late hour, and he had drove past the premises thousands of times before and not once seen the vehicle before that moment. Police immediately canvassed the area in question, where they found tire tracks in the field and boot prints leading up to Jessica's house. They had attained their first two significant pieces of evidence, which then became the foundation for the next stages of the investigation. Police immediately set up 6 roadblocks throughout the surrounding area and stopped every SUV that passed in the hope of finding a match to the tire tracks. They reportedly stopped over 200 vehicles over the next 4 days, yet had no luck, and were on the verge of reassigning their manpower from the roads to conduct foot patrols in off-road areas and pathways. However, at roughly 7:30 p.m. on February 4th, their luck did a full 180, as the sports utility vehicle of Colonel Russell Williams was stopped. He was reportedly polite and nonchalant about what he thought was a routine traffic procedure, officer and was sent on his way after just 90 seconds. Unbeknownst to him, he was immediately placed under police surveillance from that moment on, as his tires came up as a complete match to the tracks found in the field near Jessica Lloyd's house. 2 days later, on Sunday, February the 7th, he received a call from police headquarters in Ottawa asking him to visit the premises for the purpose of answering questions in relation to an ongoing investigative matter. The colonel didn't inquire further and agreed to drop into the police station immediately. He reportedly told his wife that he would be back for dinner before setting off and arrived at the headquarters shortly before 3 p.m., where he was greeted by Detective Sergeant Jim Smith, a trained polygraph technician and senior investigator of the Policing Behavioral Sciences Unit.
You just have a seat here, Russell.
I'm just going to move your gloves here. That's a little microphone, just to make sure there's nice and clear. As you can see here, everything in this room is videotaped and audio taped. You ever been interviewed by the police in a room like this before?
I have never been interviewed like this.
Oh, no? Okay.
I guess the closest to interview by NIS for top secret clearance.
Oh, yeah?
There are three types of security clearance for all military institutions serving under NATO. Confidential, secret, and the highest being top secret, which is what the colonel just specified. This takes roughly 8 months to be cleared for, and only a very select few are given this level of jurisdiction, as unauthorized disclosure of top secret information could cause exceptionally grave damage to national security. It took just over 40 seconds for the colonel to remind the detective of who he was, and just how important he was. It's a testament to his self-conceited air of invincibility and just how assured he felt in the present situation.
All right. Well, again, Russell, I appreciate you coming in.
The gas canade is casually acknowledged, yet quickly brushed to one side by the detective, followed by the informal address to the subject using his first name. He immediately sets the stage for the interview and takes the colonel down from his elevated platform for the sole purpose of stripping away confidence. This increases the telling signs in body language and intonation when information is fabricated and also decreases cognitive stamina, lessening the amount of time an individual can keep a facade before they essentially break. Placing the subject on an even platform also allows for the investigator to both exercise and mystify his own powers, which will serve a significant purpose during the later stages of the interrogation. This is all done in a manner that demoralizes the subject, while at the same time maintains an appropriate level of rapport, and gives reason for the detective's non-confrontational disposition.
An investigation like this, I mean, I'm sure you can appreciate it's been big news, especially down Belleville way. And, you know, obviously our approach to cases like this is that we don't give up on somebody being alive until mm-hmm. we get evidence that they're not. So because of that, we're treating Jessica's case as an emergent situation, obviously.
Yeah.
So we're fast-forwarding things that we might normally take our time with.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why we're here on a Sunday afternoon.
Sure.
So, again, I appreciate it.
Okay.
We're going to do a pretty thorough interview today.
Okay.
And the reason for that is because the last thing we want is to be calling people back again and again and again, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So what we're going to do is we're going to go over a number of things, and I'm going to explain what all those are to you,
okay?
I'm a big coffee guy. I don't know if you're a coffee guy or
I
not,
am a
but
coffee
I didn't
guy,
want to
actually,
drink in front of you, so.
No, I appreciate that.
All right, go ahead.
I could definitely, are they black?
Yeah, they're just black with sugar. All right, and again, like I said, this interview is going to be very thorough,
mm-hmm.
But again, I have a simple rule when I talk to people. It's I'm sure you're the same way. I treat everybody with respect. I don't know why I ask you to do the same for me. So what we're going to do is we're going to start off by going through what your rights are, okay?
Okay.
Just like everybody else, okay? Have you ever been read your rights before?
No.
I'm sure you've seen it on TV a whole bunch of times, but that's usually the American version. So
okay.
I'll go over with you briefly, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Russell, just to avoid any confusion, because people do get confused when they're talked to by the police, is
mm-hmm.
that... you're obviously not under arrest here today, okay?
Yep.
Anytime you feel you want to leave here, you feel free to do so. The door's not locked. Teresa will walk you down to the lobby anytime you want, okay?
Although the subject was free to leave at any time, there was a very subtle yet highly effective subconscious strategy set in place to try to stop this from happening. The detective has sat between Russell and the door. You will see this method utilized in almost every interrogation, as it's a subliminal message essentially telling the subject, if you want out of this room, you have to go through me. It's been argued that this can act as an imperative emotional barrier that has often prevented many suspects from leaving these areas of which they are most vulnerable and susceptible to incrimination.
If there's anything that comes up in our interview today, Russell, that you feel you want to talk to a lawyer about,
sure.
You just let me know, okay?
Sure.
And the reason for that is I want to explain to you exactly what's going on here, okay? Jessica Lloyd is one of four cases that we're currently investigating, okay? Right. And essentially what's happened is over the past about 4 or 5 months, there have been four occurrences, that, like I said, that we're looking into. Two of those occurrences occurred in September of 2009, and very briefly, they were up in the Tweed area.
Yeah.
They involved somebody entering two different women's houses in the evening hours and committing sexual acts.
Yeah.
Okay.
During 2009, there were 34 break-ins and attempted break-ins in the quiet town of Orleans, Ottawa, resulting in the theft of hundreds of intimate female garments, one incident of rape, and one incident of forcible confinement. All of these occurrences took place not far from the home of Russell Williams, who is now the prime suspect for each of these infractions at the time of his interrogation.
In November of 2009, a young lady by the name of Marie-France Comeau.
My people.
Was found murdered in her home in Brighton.
Yeah.
And we believe that there was a sexual component to that crime as well.
Okay.
Corporal Marie-France Comeau was a 37-year-old military traffic technician based at CFB Trenton. She was raped and suffocated to death inside her home in late November of 2009, which the colonel was also the prime suspect for at this moment.
And then most recently we have Jessica Lloyd's disappearance, okay? So essentially, when you're looking at those kind of crimes, we're looking at a number of different potential criminal charges, right? We're looking at issues all the way from the most serious one, which is first-degree murder, kidnapping, sexual assault, break and enter with intent to commit sexual assault, forcible confinement, okay? And so what I want to make sure you understand, and this is what we've been doing with everybody we've been talking to, is that clearly, when we find out who's responsible for one or all of those crimes, they could be charged with one or all of those offenses, okay? Whether it's you or whether it's anybody else, all right? And that's why it's important that we make sure that people understand what they have to do and what they don't have to do when they're talking to us, okay? So as I said before, any point today, you feel the need, you want to speak to a lawyer, you let me know, and we can take you to a room where you can do that in private, okay? Is there any reason you want to call a lawyer now?
Nope.
Okay.
These first two attacks happened not that far from my place in Tweed. Well, the second one did.
Yeah.
We didn't even know the first one had happened, but I understand that was reasonably close as well. But the second one was very close.
Yeah.
So certainly at the time, the OPP did a door-to-door.
Yeah.
And within a couple of days, probably the same night, so I spoke with a couple guys then.
The analysis of vocal intonation is a tricky thing when dealing with interrogations, as it cannot be used as evidence in court, yet intuition would give many the sense that discomposure is emanating from the colonel at this moment. The way he is speaking comes across as slightly nervous and unsure. He would appear to most as being agitated in the manner he is both processing information and communicating his responses. This type of cognitive recognition is a difficult thing to articulate into words, and investigators simply characterize it as gut instinct, which Detective Jim Smith would have no doubt been feeling at this moment. He would have been almost certain that the man sitting before him was guilty, simply by the way he was talking, quiet with a hint of nervousness, incongruent with how a military commander would normally carry himself.
Okay. Yeah, and I'm aware of that from looking at the different cases. And essentially, Russell, in a nutshell, that's what we wanted to talk to you about, okay? Those four cases are of concern to us. And, you know, you've kind of almost hit the nail on the head about some of our issues that kind of make us want to talk to Russell Williams, okay? Because essentially, there's a connection between you and all four of those cases. Would you agree? Geographically,
and then I guess I drive past, I would have to say there is a connection, yeah.
The colonel is asked to state his movements and activity over the past 4 days, which is known in forensic psychology as gathering pretext. The detective wants to get an initial alibi from the suspect before the confrontational phase of the interrogation begins. This is the most calm a state that he intends to keep Russell in before he ramps up the pressure, and a more relaxed suspect often results in more detailed pretext, thus more information to scrutinize and correlate with any changes made at a later stage.
Friday on the day, I was, hmm. Friday on the day I was at home most of the time. Most of the day I had a sort of a stomach flu.
Okay. In Ottawa or Tweed?
Tweed.
In Tweed?
Tweed is a village in Ontario where the colonel had a second vacation home located roughly 125 miles from his house in Ottawa.
Okay. Yeah. So we backtrack then. So all day Friday, you're at home.
Yeah.
And then what time do you leave to go to the base to sleep there on the Friday night?
Not sure. Probably just, you know, went in for just before bed. So I probably left Tweed at between 8 and 9 or so.
Okay. And you get to the base and spend the evening there and get up for the 5:30?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's right.
So we backtrack from there. When did you arrive at your home, at the cottage? I don't want to get confused between your home in Ottawa and the home in Tweed.
So, no, I had been in Tweed all week.
Yeah.
The week prior now. I think that's the case. I was in Tweed all week. Flew Saturday. Headed to Ottawa Saturday night.
Okay. So if you didn't have the stomach flu on the Friday, what was your schedule that day?
Eight, really.
Okay.
What would have been my schedule? Just a standard schedule in the office.
Okay.
So, office brief in the morning, couple of meetings. I can't remember what the specifics were going to be.
Okay, so Thursday night you slept at Tweed, or you?
Yep.
All right. And what did you do Thursday during the day?
Thursday during the day, I was at the base again. I think it was a fairly standard day. I can't recall exactly, but nothing. I was not flying, so I was at the base. So I would have gone in early in the morning, back in the evening again.
Okay.
The method of gathering pretext is then focused on the murder of Marie-France Comeau.
Okay. Now, I'm not going to walk you through November, but I'm going to take you to a date that's probably pretty fresh in your mind, the day that Marie-France Comeau.
Yeah.
Do you remember how you found out?
I do. Yeah, I was sent an email. As soon as the op staff and the base learned, they told me.
Okay.
So I got an email. I can't remember if it was late at night, early in the morning. It was certainly. I saw it. I want to say first thing in the morning because I had just come back from Ottawa. I was in Ottawa for a set of meetings on one of the days. I can't remember what day of the week we're talking about, but obviously when your people gets killed, it gets your attention. So.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I very much remember that coming in.
And how did you know Marie-France Comeau?
I'd only met her once. She was on a crew I was on just after I got to the base.
Okay. Do you know roughly when that happened?
That we were on the same crew?
The time you met her the one time there, yeah.
It was soon after I got to the base, so I don't remember exactly, but I would say in the first couple of months, so August, September.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, you got that email notifying you that something had happened.
Yeah.
Do you have any kind of a clear recollection as to how your schedule was going that week?
Well, I can't remember what day that the message came in. Just a second. I can't remember what day of the week, but I just think there was a whole bunch of activity spun up as a result, obviously. No, I can't remember the day of the week.
This was the third time in quick succession the colonel stated that he couldn't remember the answer to the question. A normal interaction between two parties would most often elicit the person posing the question to reassure the individual it was directed at. Statements along the lines of, "Don't worry if you can't remember, we'll move on," or, "It was a long time ago, it must be difficult to recollect," would be afforded as a form of consolation and to also break the uncomfortable silence. Even during a legitimate witness statement, some form of emotional assistance or encouragement will often be given, especially to someone in the midst of recollecting a distressing moment or time period from the past. On this occasion, there is no such reassurance from the detective whatsoever, only a stoic gaze and not a single shift in body posture during the moments of silence.
to, what we learned after the fact was that the MPs had learnt of her death, I think quite a bit after her body had been discovered.
Okay.
So, I think what happened, no, I'm sorry, just a second.
So if we were to you know, do a similar investigation in your background, is there anything you can think of that anybody may have misinterpreted, or anything in your history that somebody might say Russell Williams
absolutely
did this?
No.
Okay.
Be very boring.
What's that?
It'll be very boring.
All right, because essentially that's what I'm looking at. Is it? You seem like a very intelligent person, and I think you can see how a surprise like that would certainly set off some alarm bells in our investigation, right?
Okay. Yeah.
So the next thing we need to cover off is, I'll just ask you this straight out. Given the types of crimes we're investigating, do you get much chance to watch television shows, CSI, things like that?
I do watch, I prefer Law & Order, but I do watch CSI occasionally, yes.
Okay, so you have an idea of, obviously, the forensic capabilities, things like that are out there. What would you be willing to give me today to help me move past you in this investigation?
What do you need?
Well, would you be willing to supply things like fingerprints, blood samples,
sure.
Things like that?
Yeah.
Okay.
This is what is known in both psychology and philosophy as a crossroad, a moment in your life when a single and often instantaneous decision you make will take you on one of two exceedingly diverging paths in your journey. The only two pieces of evidence that police had acquired at this point in time were the tire tracks and the footprints outside the missing person's residence. What many are unaware of is that the DNA found on Marie-France Como was not admissible, as her body was highly decomposed at the time of discovery, thus making any genetic analysis virtually impossible, as this was before the era of the latest DNA testing method known as next-generation sequencing. Only one of the sexual assault victims had male DNA found on the back of her neck, yet this was by far the least severe attack, which falls into the bracket of forcible confinement, and had no exterior elements connected to the more serious infractions of murder and rape. The evidence of the tire tracks would be easily refuted by a defense team, as they were a relatively common brand for off-road vehicles, which would extinguish the BRD standard of proof, also known as guilt beyond all reasonable doubt. The only significant piece of evidence were the footprints. It was the singular and emblematic element linked to the culpability of Jessica Lloyd's disappearance, and notice how the colonel looks down at his own boots as he gives his response to the following request.
Footwear impressions?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. I think that's what we're gonna ask you to do,
okay.
All right? I told you when I came in here that I'm going to treat you with respect, and I've asked you to do the same for me. We talked about the whole idea of how we've approached you here, okay? The trying to be as discreet as possible,
mm-hmm.
Okay? But the problem is, Russell, is every time I walk out of this room, there's another issue that comes up, okay? And it's not issues that point away from you. It's issues that point at you, okay? And I want you to see what I mean, mm-hmm. All right? This is the footwear impression of the person who approached the rear of Jessica Lloyd's house,
mm-hmm.
on the evening of the 28th and 29th of January.
Yeah.
Okay. Because essentially, when you're dealing with footwear impressions, we have a gentleman on the OPP who's basically world-renowned. His name is John Norman.
Mm-hmm.
And essentially, with footwear impressions, you're in a situation where you're pretty much in the area of fingerprints, okay?
All of the previous affirmations were fabricated for the sole purpose of heightening psychological pressure. Footprints are not even close to being as indistinguishable nor incriminating as fingerprints. And although footwear and tire track examiners exist and undergo extensive training, there were none on the premises at that time. And John Norman was in fact a regular police officer who simply printed out the images just two doors away from the interrogation room.
This is a photocopy of the boot that you took off your foot.
Yeah.
Just a little while ago, okay? Now, I'm not an expert in footwear impressions, so I rely on the experts. footwear impressions are very much like fingerprint comparisons, okay? You take a look at this print, and again, this is one print. This person walked through, there's several different prints to compare. Mm-hmm. So we're gonna get features off of one print to compare, features off another print to compare.
Yeah.
These are identical. Okay. Your vehicle drove up the side of Jessica Lloyd's house. Your boots walked to the back of Jessica Lloyd's house on the evening of the 28th and 29th of January. Okay. You want discretion. We need to have some honesty, okay? Because this is getting under control really fast, Russell. Okay, really, really fast. This is getting beyond my control.
This relates to the previously stated tactic of the interrogator exaggerating and mystifying his own powers while maintaining significant level of rapport with a suspect. He's essentially telling the colonel that he is still a friend, yet the powers that he has can only benefit him if he acknowledges the accusation, which at this moment isn't a full confession, only that he was present at the scene in question. The reason the detective asserts to the suspect's presence at the crime scene while not directly accusing him of the actual crime is for the purpose of affording him multiple options of how he chooses to respond. An outright accusation can often lock up a suspect and cause them to deny everything as a reflex response, and this often leads to them requesting legal counsel and stopping the interrogation dead in its tracks. Affording the suspect an exit strategy results in a higher chance of acknowledgement. As an example, the colonel could admit that he happened to be at the crime scene at the time in question, yet think up ulterior reasons as to why he was there. It wouldn't be a full confession, yet it would get the detective one foot in the door, and this primary admittance would then become the new platform for further building the case against the suspect. Research shows that once a person has complied with a small request, they are more likely to comply with a larger demand.
All right, I came in here a few hours ago, and I called you the way I called you today because I wanted to give you the benefit of the doubt.
Mm-hmm.
But you and I both know you were at Jessica Lloyd's house, and I need to know why. Well, you need to explain it, because this is the other problem we're having, Russell, okay? Again, these decisions are made by me.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, there's a search warrant being executed at your residence in Ottawa, okay? So your wife now knows what's going on. There's a search warrant being executed at your residence in Tweed, and your vehicle's been seized, okay? You and I both know they're going to find evidence that links you to these situations. Okay. You and I both know that the unknown offender, male, on Marie-France Comeau's body is going to be matched to you, quite possibly before the evening's over. Okay? This is a major investigation. The Center of Forensic Science is on call 24 hours a day helping us with this.
Mm-hmm.
Your opportunity to take some control here and to have some explanation that anybody is going to believe is quickly expiring.
Mm-hmm.
The narrative technique is a variant of the reframing technique, which is when the interrogator reframes the risks associated with not cooperating, and also the gains associated with cooperating. In this particular instance, he's magnifying the beneficial elements of the suspect being able to tie his own narrative to the crimes, while also increasing the fear of him having that same opportunity taken away.
Okay. Russell.
Mm-hmm.
Listen to me for a second, okay? When that evidence comes in, when that DNA match, when that phone rings and somebody knocks on this door,
mm-hmm.
your credibility is gone, okay? because this is how credibility works, all right? And I know you're an intelligent person, and you probably don't need to hear this explanation, but I also know your mind's racing right now, okay? Because I've sat across a lot of people in your position over the years, mm-hmm. okay? The bottom line is that as soon as we get that piece of evidence that solidifies it, mm-hmm. DNA, okay? As soon as the expert in footwear impressions, the expert in tire impressions, calls and says, yes, I've examined those and they're mm-hmm. a match. Mm-hmm. It's all over. Because as soon as that happens, where's your credibility? Where's your believability? Russell, you know there's only one option. What other option is there?
What's the option?
Well, I don't think you want the cold-blooded psychopath option. I might be wrong. Because okay, don't get me wrong, I've met guys who actually kind of enjoyed the notoriety, got off on it, got off on having that label, Bernardo being one of them. I don't see that in you. If I saw that in you, I wouldn't be back in here talking to you, quite frankly.
This is in essence the reframing technique that can also be interpreted as the ego up and fear up techniques combined. The detective is heightening the perceived benefits of the suspect's character being presented in a better light, while also increasing the fear of his character being further vilified.
But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe you got me fooled. I don't know. This is over. And it can have a bad ending where Jessica's parents continue to wonder where her daughter's lying. And I don't know. I mean, obviously, there's a huge search still underway, and it'll continue. It'll continue until her body's found. That might even happen tonight, for all I know.
While sighs are often attributed to sadness and frustration, they have also been linked to the fight or flight response, as the additional accumulation of oxygen is essentially preparing you for battle or to safely run away. The thought of a victim's body being found that same evening evoked a subconscious feeling of danger in the suspect, which most likely resulted in this anatomical reaction.
Once that happens, then I don't know what other card you would have to play. What are we going to do? Russell. What are we going to do?
Call me Russ, please.
Okay. What are we gonna do, Russ? Is Jessica somewhere we can find her easily? Like, is this something where I can make a call and tell somebody to go to a location and they're gonna find her, or is this something where we have to go and take a walk? Russ, maybe this would help. Can you tell me what the issue is you're struggling with?
Hard to believe this is
happening. Why is that? Why is it hard to believe? Russ, is there anything you want from me? Is there anything you want me to explain? Is there something missing that you're struggling with that I can shed some light on for you?
I'm struggling with how upset my wife is right now.
This investigation will end up costing no less than $10 million. Easy. And they will say no to nothing. Any request this major case manager makes on this case, they've already been told it's approved. Don't even bother asking. So what am I doing, Russ? I put my best foot forward here for you, but I really have. I don't know what else to do to make you understand the impact of what's happening here. Did we talk?
I want to minimize the impact on my wife.
So do I.
So how do we do that?
Well, we start by telling the truth. So where is she? Is she close to where she lives? I've got maps of that general area. Which town is she near? Why don't we start there?
I'm not sure. If you give me a map of that covers Calabar down to the highway and over to Tweed and south, I'll show you.
Let me see what I got here. I might have something. Is she inside, outside? Is she close to a road?
Yep.
All right. Is it something where is she buried, or is she somewhere where if you walk there you would fairly easily see her?
It's here.
Okay. Okay. I'll be right back. Okay. Do you want any water or anything?
Sure.
Okay. I'll be right back. How long has she been there for?
A little over a week.
Was it fairly quick from the time she left?
Friday night.
Friday night?
Yeah.
So where was she between Thursday night and Friday night?
In Tweed.
With you?
Yeah.
How long was she alive for?
Almost 24 hours, not quite.
Russ, you're doing the right thing here. Okay. Barry, the obvious question I'm going to have for you is, when they go there, and they'll be there shortly, they're going to find her?
Oh, yeah.
What do you want to talk about?
Because it's pretty wide open now, eh?
Yeah.
What do you want to know?
Well, do you want to work forwards or backwards?
Doesn't matter.
Why don't we start with Jessica?
Okay.
How does that start for you?
I saw her in her house on her treadmill. Wednesday night, I guess. Then I noticed she wasn't there Thursday. So I got into the house to look around. Then left. Noticed she'd come home. So I went back in. through the back patio door while she was sleeping. So I woke her up. Didn't hit her. She only hit her once. Friday night. Well, so I raped her in her house. And then I took her to the car and took her to Tweet. And spent the day in Tweet. And then I hit her as we were walking. She thought we were leaving. Hit her on the back of the head.
Okay.
Well, what did the hit on the back of the head do?
Well, I was surprised at her skull gave way. She was there and immediately unconscious. I strangled her.
Okay. What did you hit her with?
Flashlight.
Okay. In the house or outside the house?
In the house.
So when that happened, was she, did she have clothes on or was she naked?
Yeah,
or?
She was dressed.
Okay. So when we find her, is she going to have those clothes on too?
Yeah.
Okay. Marie France Como.
There was an open window in the basement of her her house. When she was away, I went in there a couple of nights before she came home, looked around. I went back in there late at night when she was at home. She was on the phone in her bedroom. She actually discovered me in the basement. She was trying to get her cat to come upstairs, and the cat was in the basement, had seen me and was fixated on me in the corner. She couldn't get the cat up, so she came downstairs to try and get the cat, and I'm not sure why she came over to me. I guess the cat was staring at me, and she was wondering what the cat was staring at. The lights were on. So when she spotted me, I had the same flashlight. I subdued her. Tied her up. Brought her upstairs. And strangled her later in the morning. Well, more suffocated her. Tape. Left her there.
How did you subdue her? And when you say subdued her in the basement, what did you do?
Well, I had the same flashlight. And, she saw me right away, so it's just, I hit her a couple of times and around her head, try and knock her out. Didn't, but she was bleeding a little bit. Eventually, after a struggle, subdued her.
Did she recognize you?
No, I had stuff on my face.
So then you go upstairs, and you said she suffocated?
Well, I suffocated her. I put tape on her. I put tape on her mouth, and then I put tape on her nose and held it there so she couldn't breathe.
He then goes on to confess the two assaults that occurred in his hometown of Orleans, disclosing every single piece of concessive detail that authorities were hoping to attain. This prompts the detective to then delve deeper into the psychological reasoning and rationale behind the suspect's motives.
Why do you think these things happen? Have you spent much time thinking about that?
About why?
Yeah.
Yeah. But I don't know the answers. And I'm pretty sure the answers don't matter.
Well, let me ask you this. Did you like or dislike these women?
Attaining a specific and detailed motive for a violent crime holds two purposes. The primary reason is to refute any potential claims of mental instability or insanity from a defense team, whether it be during a trial or a sentencing hearing. The secondary purpose is for the further detraction of the defendant's character, which can often result in a more lengthy sentence being rendered.
I didn't know any of them.
Okay.
I had met Maddie Franz that one time in her airplane.
Okay. Now, I guess when you're going through these things, let's talk about Jessica, because she was there with you for the whole day, right? Mm-hmm. What kind of feelings were you experiencing while you were with her that day?
Oh, she was a very nice girl.
Do you know why you killed her?
Well, I think I killed her because I knew that her story would be recognized.
Well, let me ask you this. Is it two lived, right? And two died. What was the difference in your mind between...
You know, she was serving military, right?
Mm-hmm.
It would have been difficult for investigators to ignore that connection.
Okay. Yeah, makes sense. So you go in, she's sleeping, and what do?
Well, I snuck up to the side of her bed. She woke up. But she did as I said. So I didn't hit her.
What did you say?
I said, lie down on your tummy.
Okay.
She did. I tied her up.
What'd you tie her up with?
Some rope I brought.
You tie her hands behind her back, and then what happens?
I took her clothes off.
Okay. And then what happened?
I raped her.
A rape could mean a lot of different things. What kind of sexual act took place?
Just vaginal and oral.
Okay. Oral, who was performing the oral sex?
Me on her and her on me.
Okay. Any condoms used or anything like that?
No.
No. So, and again, correct me if I'm wrong. Vaginal intercourse. Her performing oral sex on you, and you performing oral sex on her.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember what order those things occurred in?
Yeah. Sex. Then I raped her. And then later on I made her perform oral sex on me.
Okay. Any kind of conversation happening when this is going on?
Yeah, a little bit.
What was being said?
I threatened her before she, before I had her perform oral sex.
What did you say?
Well, I put a zip tie around her neck. and then I would pull it if I didn't like what she would do.
Okay. So she did what you told her to do?
Mm-hmm.
Any issues there? Any reason to pull it?
No.
So do you remember if you ejaculated at that point or at any point?
Not at that point, but later on.
Okay. So the oral sex finishes, and then what happens next?
Well, I continued to rape her, and I had her put on some of her underwear. Took some pictures, lots of pictures. And then got her dressed, walked back to the truck.
Okay. At what point did you decide that she was going to leave with you?
I'm not sure. That wasn't necessarily always the plan.
Do you remember the conversation about leaving? Was there any... Did she say anything about that? Or what was she saying to you?
She was... certainly cooperative.
A cooperative can mean a number of different things. Was she excited about leaving with you? I mean, I don't want to be sarcastic, but...
No, she just didn't put up too much of a fuss.
Okay. Did she try and negotiate with you at all, or...?
No.
What did she say?
Well, I told her that I would let her go later on.
Okay. When you take her out of your house, is she still bound, or?
Yep.
How is that done?
Just hands behind her back.
Okay. What about her feet? Anything there?
No, she was walking freely.
So where does she sit in your truck when you get to the truck?
Front seat, passenger side.
Okay. And where do you go?
Straight to Tweed.
Straight to your house in Tweed, or straight to just the town?
Straight to the house.
No stops anywhere?
No.
So you get home, what, 4:35, you say?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then what happens?
Well, she just go to the bathroom. And, a quick shower, washer. Then we went into my bedroom and went to sleep a little bit. She was tied up.
Do you remember how long you slept for?
Not long, maybe a couple hours.
Do you know if she slept?
I don't know.
So you get up from that, and what happens next?
Seizure, actually. She felt it coming on, and because she'd had some before. Lasted quite a while. Got her dressed into the family room, and anyway, she recovered. She got obviously stress.
How do you know she had them before?
She told me.
Did she tell you why she gets them?
Well, she suggested it was stress.
So she recovered from that?
Yep, she stayed with her and talked her through it and make sure she didn't bite her tongue.
And then what happened?
Well, then we had a little lie down right there because she was obviously exhausted. Put a cover over her and she went to sleep. Then I got her dressed. She thought she was leaving. 15. Fruit. And then as we were walking out, I struck her on the back of the head.
Okay. When did you decide to do that?
Well, I was pretty sure that I wasn't going to let her leave. But, you know, the idea of striking her on the head was developed in the afternoon. Her skull gave way a little bit, felt like, and there was a lot of blood, so I think that's what happened. She was immediately unconscious, and then I strangled her.
How'd you strangle her?
The same rope. Just put her on her neck.
Okay. And how did you know she was dead?
Well, her body stopped moving.
So what did you do after that?
I bound her up, put her in the garage, and then I went into the base.
Why'd you go to the base?
Pardon me?
Why'd you go to the base?
Because I was flying early the next morning.
Okay. So you get back to Tweed, and what happens next?
I took Jessica's body to that spot.
Okay. And how did you leave her?
I just left her tucked behind a fairly large rock.
Okay. Is that duct tape still on her? And what else is on her?
A couple of towels wrapped around her head. And the top and pants she was wearing, jeans.
Okay. So you go in, and you're in the basement. And whereabouts in the basement are you?
By the furnace.
Okay. And what are you doing? What's your sort of plan at that point?
I was waiting for her to go to bed.
Okay. And how long did that take?
Well, she didn't. Because then she came down looking for the cat.
And what is she wearing at that point?
She wasn't wearing anything to start with.
So when she came down to the basement, she had no clothes on?
Mm-hmm. She had some sort of a shawl over her shoulder.
Okay.
And she immediately dropped when she saw me.
Did she say anything when she saw you?
She did. She called out, "You bastard."
Okay. And then what happened?
Then I subdued her, as I described.
By hitting her with that red flashlight?
Mm-hmm.
How did you tie her at that point? Like, I know you used the rope, but what did you tie her up like?
Just pulled her hands behind her back and just tied her wrists together.
Okay. And then what happened after that?
Then I took her upstairs.
Did she go upstairs under her own power, or did you carry her?
No, she passed out on the stairs. And then I carried her up.
Why do you think she passed out?
I expect from the hits to her head.
So you carried her up to where?
To her bedroom, put her on the bed.
Okay. And then what happened?
As I described, I think she's on the bed. I raped her over a period of time.
Okay, and again, just to be specific, what sex acts took place?
Just vaginal.
Your penis and her vagina?
Yeah.
Any condom use?
No.
Did you ejaculate?
No.
Did you ejaculate at any point with her?
No.
Okay. And then what happens next?
Well, as I described, I suffocated her using their tape.
So while you're with Marie Franz, what kind of conversations are taking place? Anything she said to you stick out in your mind?
No, I taped her mouth. There's no conversation.
Okay. When did you tape her mouth?
As soon as I got her up to the bedroom.
Why did you decide to do that?
Because she was, quite aggressive.
In what way?
I was confident she would have screamed, given the chance.
Do you remember how you left her residence?
Back door. Patio door.
Okay. Well, I guess I just have a couple of questions for you. I mean, I'm sure there's going to be more questions, but I guess what's on my mind right now, Russ, is what made you decide to tell me this tonight?
Mostly to make my wife's life easier.
Okay. How do you feel about what you've done? Like what?
Disappointed.
Let me ask you this. If this didn't come to the point it's at right now, if for whatever reason you didn't end up on our radar, so to speak, do you think it would have happened again?
I was hoping not.
The details that were out already didn't prepare anyone for what was heard in court today, as Colonel Russell Williams pleaded guilty to 2 murders, 2 sexual assaults, and more than 80 break-ins, and many were described in detail. Along with each count came graphic photo evidence and a clear pattern to Williams' escalating crimes. You should be aware some of the facts are highly disturbing.
Peter, the evidence presented in court today painted a chilling portrait of a predator who escalated from break-and-enters to sexual assault to murder, giving the public its first real glimpse of Russell Williams' criminal mind.
It's the most graphic insight into Williams' double life, and it started soon after Williams shuffled into the courtroom, shackled and pale. In a voice that was at times barely audible, Williams pled guilty to all 88 charges against him. Then, slumped in his chair, his eyes downcast, he listened expressionless while the Crown exhaustively recounted the case against him. Until now, it's been reported Williams would steal women's undergarments and clothing when he broke into dozens of homes in Tweed and Ottawa. But what emerged in court was even more disturbing. That Williams often targeted the homes and the belongings of young girls. The first such incident occurred near his home in Tweed, starting a pattern that would be repeated over and over again. Today, the court released 27 photos taken by Williams himself, all of them in his own home. Of the thousands of pictures he took of lingerie stolen from drawers, closets, even laundry baskets, William laid them all out meticulously. And he tried them on. There were several similar photos released, but the CBC chose to crop them. In court, there were many more graphic pictures shown of Williams masturbating while wearing stolen garments. Police say Williams often spent hours in a given home, especially in the bedrooms of young girls he had stalked.
It's very disturbing. It's very troubling. My hat's off to the investigators that worked full-time on this for months and months and months to sift through this information.
And there was a lot of information to sift through. Williams kept meticulous logs of every single crime he committed and buried those logs and photographs deep into his home computer's hard drive. And the Crown argued his obsession with photographs and videos continued when he took photos of the sexual assaults of Marie-France Comeau and Jessica Lloyd and video of Comeau's murder. That evidence has yet to be released. Lloyd's family is bracing for a devastating week.
He pled guilty. We know what the sentence is going to be. Why is the court going through all this Why are we hearing the things we're hearing, seeing the things we're seeing in such detail?
It is. It would seem on the surface to be an open and shut case, Peter, but lawyers and the Crown especially and police too wanted to lay out to the public the scope and the extent of their investigation, the sheer number of crimes, the horrific nature of the crimes, and especially to satiate the public's interest in such a public figure.
He was a killer with the ultimate cover. As a base commander in the Canadian Air Force, Colonel Russell Williams comforted families of the fallen, rubbed shoulders with the Prime Minister, and even flew planes for the Queen. But no one, including his wife, knew that he was also a sexual deviant, burglar, rapist, and murderer. And today, what began as fetish and fantasy led to a life sentence of solitary misery.
Jim Smith was later praised for his impassive and methodical approach to the interrogation, as he used one rational argument after another to slowly convince the suspect that his only option was to confess, void of any antagonistic strategies whatsoever. It was perfectly executed, and Smith became somewhat of a cult figure in the realm of criminology and police culture. He has been offered a multitude of highly lucrative deals from a variety of international publishing companies to write a book on his background and expertise, all of which he has refused, and continues to work as a senior criminal investigator to the present day.